As the milking carousel rotates, the mechanism releases a portion of feed at each position. It's a one-size-fits-all dose for all batches. We are more focused on efficiency, for example, trying to use as few purchased inputs as possible. We formulate the salts here, and we formulate the feeds here. It is a feed with between 18% and 20% protein based on barley, soybean hulls, and soybean meal, as well as salt. This group is designed to produce a maximum of 30 liters and currently produces between 20 and 30 liters.
Hello everyone, welcome to our Santa Fe channel. I am here with Alfredo and we are going to show you the entire farm. Please, Alfredo.
Hello, how are you? I am Alfredo, an agronomist, and we are in the fourth generation here. Well, the work with milk started in 1912, initially with cheese production. And from that time until now, it has never stopped. In other words, my great-grandfather, my grandfather, my father, and now me, we started with cheese production in that area over there. We produced cheese until 1973, mainly because at that time, there was no logistics to transport the milk. When the Conoprole line was inaugurated, it began to be taken to the factory. Since then, we stopped making cheese and started producing only milk. Also, historically, we produce cereals such as wheat and flax, which we no longer plant. This also contributed a part of our income. Currently, we have part of the farm with compost bedding and another part on pasture. The cows spend some time on the bedding and another on the pasture.
Let's see, how many animals do you have?
Currently, we have 320 milking cows, and the idea is to increase to around 400 or 500.
And what is the average production?
Currently, we are averaging 27.5 liters per cow. We hope in the coming days to reach 28 or 29 liters. The goal is to maintain these levels, as it is where we achieve a margin, an extra profit.
And how much fat does the milk have?
We have 3.80% fat and 3.50% protein. We are talking about crude protein, not true protein. The installation was done in 2014. It is a rotary milking parlor with 50 places.
How many milkings do you do? Three?
No, we do two milkings. We always try to do things in the most friendly way, with the least number of tasks possible.
And here, what is the diet of the dry cows?
The diet of the dry cows is the same as the cows that are about to calve, with the difference that the dry cows receive a little less protein, a little less carbohydrates, and more fiber. And we add anionic salts, along with the feed supplement during the transition.
And what are the ingredients?
Corn silage, soybean hulls, soybean meal, corn silage, straw bales, and slow release urea.
Is this the high production group?
No, it's the first lactation group. Even so, they are producing 30 liters because almost all of them calved at the same time. Another important thing, calving is continuous, but we try to concentrate most of the calvings in the months of March, April, and May, but they never completely stop. This means that the heifers, for example, are numerous at this time. So now, for example, this group was completed with the cows from March, April, and May. So we also adjust the diet with them in mind, and even though they are heifers, first lactation and everything, they are reaching 30 liters. But this is also partly due to the fact that they are all between 70 days post-calving until yesterday. So it's a group that will stay together almost all the time. Ah, and the feed dispenser there was designed by my father with a blacksmith. As always, the goal is to keep it simple. As the carousel milking parlor rotates, a mechanism releases a portion of feed at each position. It's a single dose for all groups. There's no adjustment, but it also serves as an incentive for the cows to enter. Another thing we try to do is to encourage the cows through stimuli, the intuitive stimuli that the cow has. For example, now they come and want to enter because they know they have feed. Then The other group wants to leave because there's also silage at the exit. So it's like, it's more natural. Yes, and if we change that, For example, if we decide to give the silage to that group first, the logistics change completely. That is, the cow that is calm and already has a routine and that moves on impulse, wanting to eat, drink water, stay in the shade, and so on. If you learn to manage her this way, management becomes much simpler. These are things you learn by being here every day, observing the cows, seeing what is happening with them.
How is the feed? Is it pelleted?
It's pelleted. Currently, that is, it's not a formulated feed. It's basically soybean hulls. Then we adjust the diet for everyone, and that's it. They eat 2 kilos daily, that is a little over a kilo per shift. But we always try to ensure it's a pelleted ingredient to avoid problems with dust, to not create too much mess with the dust. Another thing we try is to have an ingredient that's included in all diets. For example, the 2 kilos of hulls are included in all the groups. Then it's just a matter of calculating when deciding whether to add something else or not.
It makes diet formulation easier because you already know how much is there.
Yes, yes. And another thing is trying to ensure that it's something continuously available. That is, we also look for inputs that we can use for 6 months, or if possible, for a year, even better. Sometimes we used high-pro soy, the high-protein one, to say, okay, it's there. But then there was a lot of pasture, and the grazing cows ended up consuming too much. They might not even need that supplementation, so we switched to another input. This sometimes makes everything more complex.
How is the milking routine carried out? What are the processes?
The processes we do here are quite basic, also for simplicity's sake. Basically, we connect the cows for milking. The forage dripping is done once a day in the morning, and after that, it's just about connecting it. We're considering the possibility, maybe later this year, of installing a teat cleaner. It would be a brush that cleans the teat, disinfects, and dries. But we believe that if it's not done properly, I mean done well, it's better not to do it at all. As you can see, the cows are dry. What we really try to do is avoid mud to keep the cows dry and clean. If you look at the cows over there, they're dry and clean, so either we do it this way or we don't do it at all. Right now, we don't do anything beyond simply disconnecting.
Yes, the priority is that they arrive dry.
Yes, that they arrive dry and clean. Now, if they don't arrive dry and clean, sometimes, for example, when there's a lot of pasture, or during times when we use a lot of pasture, there's mud and the cows arrive dirty. In that case, sometimes we need to place an extra person to do the pre-dipping. That is, we clean, pre-dip, and dry. But these are specific situations. And another thing we try to do is size the groups and everything else so that the process is as quick as possible. We always want to do the job well, but for example, this group is done in half an hour. The cow spends half an hour at dawn, and the rest of the time is spent eating, drinking water, socializing, lying down, doing whatever she wants. This is one of the fundamental things we try to do, and the impact of this is enormous. Many times we would formulate the diets or other aspects, and the cows wouldn't reach the targets we had set. But now this group is designed to produce 30 liters at most, and they are there between 29 and 30 liters, meaning they are reaching it. And this is largely due to comfort. Few hours of stress and many hours where they can do whatever they want, whether eating, sleeping, socializing.
How are the management practices carried out?
Here, this calf barn was built in 2005, I believe. The person in charge here is Luis, who has been with us for 37 years. He has seen the entire process from when we had nothing. The calves were raised in a grove, then in a small barn, until we reached what was built in 2005. In any case, there are still some things missing. The calves stay 24 hours in the place where they are born, then move to these small individual pens where they remain for about 3 weeks. We try to keep them in these pens for as little time as possible because the comfort is not ideal. It's something we still need to improve. After that, they move to a collective space where they drink milk and start eating feed. And when we see that they are doing well, they switch to a diet that is solely solid. The feed is also formulated here, prepared over there. It's a feed with between 18 and 20% protein based on barley, soybean hulls, and soybean meal, along with salt. Last year, we couldn't make chopped straw. What we used to do was add chopped straw to the feed, and then we offered a single feed. We gave it ad libitum because it contained 12% straw. This year, we couldn't chop straw due to a lack of time, so the straw is provided in rolls. That's why we also included soybean hulls as a source of fiber. And, well, the calves are here. Currently, there are 150 heifers, all females, because the males are raised by someone else. They are sold at 10 days of age. The heifers stay here until we can accommodate them. It's not so much based on weight or age, but on capacity. Now, for example, with 150, we are almost at full capacity. So when it's time to start the rearing, we'll have to transfer some of the smaller heifers. Smaller, at 4 or 5 months old. But we try to raise them all. The longer they stay here, the better they adapt during rearing.
What are the rates you have here?
Here, we have a mortality rate of approximately 2 to 3%. We've managed to improve a lot, especially after my girlfriend, my partner, took on the responsibility for colostrum management and disinfection of the calves, and the whole process to ensure that the calf gets a good start in life. And although the infrastructure we have, the facilities, are not 100% adequate to provide the ideal comfort for the calves, we've managed to ensure that they get a good start so that they don't suffer. We only use milk. We don't use milk replacer. That's one of the things we changed. The milk is not pasteurized. The equipment has the option to pasteurize, but we don't use it. And like everything, it's a process of trial and error. When we adjust something that works, we don't change it anymore.
And regarding the solid diet, the feed, after how long and for how long is it provided?
The solid feed in the first days, which are the 2-3 weeks when they are in the pens, they don't have access to solid feed. Then when they enter the collective room, they have feed available ad libitum. That is, they have access to the feeders, which we can see over there, where they can eat freely. Now there's nothing left for them, but they eat from these feeders here. They have feed available all the time, and they also have water available all the time over there. When the calf starts consuming more than 2 kilos of feed, that's when we cut off the milk and transfer them to the next group of calves. In any case, each time we give milk, we do a sorting. The person who gives the milk, if you look here, you'll see that they are all larger calves. So, for example, I believe these here are only getting milk once a day. He adjusts the amount they consume. And because we have larger calves like these, and we have the smaller ones like those over there, here, the calves in the collective group have all this area to go outside, and their shelter is here. For example, if it rains, they all stay inside. And if it's sunny, like now, and the weather is good, they all stay outside. And when it's hot, they also stay inside, and we can see them there as they are. Normally, we do treatments like using Vietine or something similar. But if there are serious problems, the animal is cold. However, this has improved a lot since we started confining. By confining, and especially with the use of compost, we've practically eliminated concrete. So this puts us in a bit of a dilemma. Sometimes we think the compost bedding in the area where the cows eat don't have flooring. This requires a lot of work for filling and cleaning. But at the same time, we realize that we don't have foot problems either. So it's a bit, these are issues that come up. For example, compost isn't as aggressive as a freestall because it doesn't involve constant use of concrete. Here, the calves go into the areas with compost and then stay on the ground. And of course, the downside is that if it rains, it turns to mud. If it rains for a month, they go through difficulties because they don't have a roof, they don't have anything. These are the calves that no longer drink milk and eat only solid feed. Right now, they're consuming 4 kilos of feed per calf. They also have bales available ad libitum, and they usually eat 200 to 300 grams, not much more than that. According to the capacity we have here, we can accommodate between 20 and 25 calves. So what we do, for example, the current group has 48 calves. They are divided into two groups and fed twice a day. They all stay together, but really all we do is count them. We make sure 24 or 25 go in, and it's done. Then they are transferred to the other pen, and the other 25 go in. We refill the feed, and this is done in the morning and in the afternoon, like now. Only with water and hay. And here they can come in and out whenever they want. They have this outdoor area where they can go out. When it's sunny like today, they all stay outside. But if it rains or the weather is bad, they all come inside. Well, I took the course in 2021. I think it was in 2022. Actually, I don't remember exactly. I wanted to take it because I wanted to learn a bit more and see the technologies being used in the United States. The truth is, it has been very useful for formulating diets and dealing with many aspects of management. How to read the feeders, assess barn capacities, formulate diets, and many other things that have been very useful to us. Formulating feeds for the calves, detecting symptoms in the cows when there's a problem. And well, it has allowed us to simplify many tasks, do everything more economically and increase efficiency, and also have many tools to assess how the cows are doing and make comparisons. For example, the efficiency of feed use, fat-corrected milk, or energy-corrected milk. And these are tools that I believe are very powerful to make this work. And at the same time, we have a group with whom we maintain a fluid dialogue, because the realities of each country are not the same. And many times when we see what we can improve or when we have doubts, we consult during the live classes. That's very good. Really, I encourage people to take it. It's technical work. There's a lot to learn. This is something continuous. You always have to study. It doesn't matter how many master's degrees you have or how many things you've done. You have to keep studying. And that seems fundamental to me. Super useful.